I keep trying to find a good window to start, but everybody was just kept coming in. I'm flying solo now, which is horrifying. But there's a good reason that I'm flying solo. It's because I'm announcing my co-host. I really, really don't think I need an introduction for any of these three guys, because they've already been introduced, and because if you're here, you probably know them. Please don't let that stop you from giving them a huge round of applause for Robert, Carsten, and Christian.
Thank you, Maya. That sounded like David Letterman's show, My Next Guest Doesn't Need Introduction. We're flattered. Yeah, so, well, this is a bit spontaneous. We are kind of a drop-in replacement. No, not really drop-in replacement, but no.
We couldn't replace Sebastian.
Sebastian Herzl's talk, who sadly is sick at home and can't join us here. So we had that task to spontaneously come up with something. And so Carsten and Christian mostly prepared something from our project diaries, and want to share a bit what we found, like the curious, useful, and nasty, and hope that you'll get some insights from that.
Exactly. So usually people don't read the fine print, so you don't need to really take, you know, pay attention to that. But I wanted to say that, I mean, we see a lot of things in a very wide variety of projects, and oftentimes we think, this can be done different and this can be done in a better way, but there's no silver bullet in IT usually. So there's always, you know, a discussion point maybe, and you can then argue about, yeah, but we did it because this and that back then, and that oftentimes makes sense, and so it's not bad per se what we see in most of the cases. And if you actually recognize your own code maybe, or think, oh, this is probably about that project of ours, don't worry, it could be, but it's not necessarily your code. It could be someone else's that's just doing the same weird or interesting things.
Maybe it helps to understand this, that, I mean, this is our whole company now, so if we, this is the truck factor here on stage, so if something drops down from the ceiling. And what we partly do is, what we do, and I have to emphasize, not for financial reasons, but for fun reasons, we offer some developer help desk to agencies, so you can drop some NEOS or Flow questions in our ticket system, and we'll give our best to answer them. And yeah, so we know a lot of projects of all different kinds of sizes, and usually I would say from this conference, like half of the companies who are here are our customers somehow. And this is what we draw from, right?
Exactly.
So, I guess...
I try to put the things that we collected into categories. So they are not named nasty and curious and
things. Ugly.
So ugly, it's more like, okay, what you maybe should or should not do. And one thing is, don't try to work against the framework. Or, as you could say very fittingly in our case, is go with the flow. Because sometimes we see code where you go like, okay, this looks weird to me. I can see where this is coming from because someone read documentation on, for example, a library that we wrap specifically for flow use, but someone didn't realize that and looked at the original library's documentation and used what they found there to implement things. So one nice example of this is people using SwiftMailer in Flow and NEOS projects, which is perfectly fine if you ignore the, well, SwiftMailer has been deprecated thing. But let's just don't put that aside for now. So SwiftMailer used that as we intended to you to use it because we have this Neos SwiftMailer package, which pulls in SwiftMailer as a dependency and does some nice wrapping around that. So recently I had this project where mails were being sent, and I obviously did not want to risk sending mails to some client directly or someone on the internet. So I configured SwiftMailer using the Neos SwiftMailer, you know, transport options to define an SMTP transport pointing to a local mail crab instance, which is MailHawk or MailCatcher or whatever. Or you could also use, I don't know, something else. So that's what I wanted to do. So I called up the page and submitted something, and I got an exception saying, well, undefined key host in this transport. I was like, what? Why? I configured it, and it should just work. So I looked at the code, and this is actually a snippet of the code that I saw. So what it does is it injects settings somewhere further up on screen. And then it uses those settings to manually build a Swift SMTP transport instance, registers a plugin for logging there. And if you look closely, it even has this comment, or to use the echo logger, which is like, OK, this comes from some example in some documentation. So you can now do this or use this plugin. So, OK, maybe. I don't know. That's why I always delete comments when I copy something from Stack Overflow, so you can't. Okay. And then it creates a message using new Swift message. And that is all kind of, you know, because this thing up there is what caused the exception message for me. Because obviously, well, I did configure something else. I configured a completely different transport. So why does it do this here? And it does hard-coded logging calls. So why would I do that? Probably to find out if my actually mail sending codes would work, but I can do that in a different way. Or maybe I don't trust anything in there to work at all, so I do logging, whatever. So I eventually stripped that down a bit. Because if you create an actual Neos SwiftMailer message, you can just tell that mail to send itself. And it will then magically use whatever transport you have configured. You could also do a logging transport or an mbox transport. It's less code. And if you want to have the logging, then use the logging transport. If you want to send it as we intended to. It makes your life easier. And it allows to actually use the centralized configuration.
I'm curious when we'll find out that there are code snippets, and we see by the comments that they are created with ChatGPT, right?
Yeah, that'll be interesting. But we'll never know, probably, because ChatGPT itself doesn't even know where it took
the
example from.
We'll recognize the style.
It could be. So another example that goes into the same direction, handling persistent resources. Back in the days when we were still young and Flow was on the verge of becoming an existing thing, Robert thought a lot about how to handle resources, and that, you know, relying on a file system might not be a good idea because you could use something in the cloud eventually. That was like pre-cloud days, where cloud was like, oh yeah, maybe at some point in
when
time.
When cloud was still bad weather, yes.
Yeah. So I saw this, which, well, yeah, okay, it does some importing and it checks something, and then it, you know, imports a file and it reads that file, and yeah, but what is this? So it creates a document, it adds it to the repository and persists it. Why does it do that? Okay, so it ends up in the place the next line is expecting it to be in, which is resources persistent, and then it does the manual hash splitting thing, and then it uses that path and file name to read the file. So
who actually worked on a PHP level with persistent resources already?
Well, that's quite a few.
Okay. Maybe we need to explain that a bit, because not everyone has been doing that, because the whole idea of this concept of persistent resources is that all files which you can upload, like images or so, which are not static in your Git code, that they have an abstraction, so we don't want to let you work with paths, because it could be that these files are actually not in a local file system, but in a cloud storage, for example. So this this looks a bit like someone didn't get that first idea, yeah, of persistent resources, because now you have these hard-coded path again. But for example, in our case, you would never find that file again on such a path.
No, in Beach there isn't any file there. It's in Google Cloud, so it's somewhere else, and you shouldn't even want to know. And also, even if you had been using file storage, it could still be at a different place if someone changed the configuration, because this fan out of the files into directories, you know, first letter of the hash, second, third, fourth, that can be switched off and on. And so it could be different on a different system with a different configuration. So you could do this instead. The slide might look broken, but I tried to keep the line that is actually has been kept on the same line. So what you see is all this, you know, make it a document. There's even more code down below, which then deletes it again and persists again. So but all that is gone. And what you just do is you want to use a file function on a file that is actually, you know, in the file system. Okay, there is create temporary local copy on a persistent resource. So if you didn't know that, now you know, and you can get rid of quite a few lines of code. And this works even with the cloud storage, because it will just pull it down, put it into a temporary location on your file system, and you can
work
with that.
Or you just use the stream and don't have any local.
Or you just use the stream. What I mean, yeah.
Yeah.
You could work in very different ways also with a CSV import. This is like, you know, you could optimize this further, obviously.
Yeah.
But as far as flow goes, this is already a lot better.
You can also just get the data from the persistent resource. Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, so next topic, which is kind of, you know, this has been deleting lines, so keep it lean and clean is the next thing you should always try to do to your code base. And there's this, you know, bullet point, misty dependencies is what I called it. Sometimes when we get into a project, it's often because we are tasked with updating something. You know, we do update all the dependencies. And then the first thing is, yeah, okay, so what dependencies are there, and are they actually needed, and which part of the system actually needs which of these dependencies? And then sometimes you see this huge composer manifest at the project level, the root manifest, and it has all the dependencies. And then some of the packages in distribution packages, yeah, this one has actually three dependencies, but with a death star constraint, so no further narrowing of the scope. These other three packages don't have any dependencies declared. And then you look into the code and you find out, well, they are actually using these dependencies. So what I would always advise is declare dependencies in the package actually using them, because it makes it a lot easier to find out what you need to change, or what packages you potentially need to touch when you update a specific dependency. Also, it makes the whole dependency resolution step in Composer quite a bit faster. So,
how do you handle that in your projects? Who's responsible for updating dependencies? Do you have, like, when someone sees it, or is there a specific... Do you have any strategy for that? Yeah, well...
Just do it. Wow.
I think any strategy or non-strategy is completely fine, unless you do that in your CI pipeline. Please never do that. Never let Jenkins do Composer update. Please. Yeah. Yes.
I can subscribe to that. Yeah, definitely.
And we say that because we've seen that.
We've seen it all. Also, we've seen the opposite. Like, no, I don't do Composer update. I don't touch this log file. Someone else can do it, and then everyone thinks that, and then it's not updated.
Oh, there's even something worse than CI pipeline. Those projects which develop on the production server where they do composer update on the live side. That's an extra.
It has been a while, though. I don't know.
No, it hasn't.
Everyone, not me.
Okay.
I recently had one of those.
My clients do that by now. Whatever. So, exactly. So let's say you find some dependency you need to update. Why would that be? And why would that be a problem to, you know, have to know why this specific dependency is actually in use? So the next thing is dependencies versus syntactic sugar, which is... Sometimes I recently had to update a project, and there was a specific package blocking an update to Neos 7.3 because it required a Guzzle version 6 something that I needed to update. So I was like, okay, let's hope this is not going to be a blocker. So then I looked at what does this package actually do, and it turns out that the package was a wrapper for Guzzle. So, okay, maybe it's not that hard to fix, I thought. So I checked, and yes, this package actually did not even have a newer version allowing the newer Guzzle version. So I looked into what it actually does, and I found this code, which says, okay, response is ztdps.json URL, and then some parameters. And it gets back a response, and if it's success, it creates a token from this API response. Okay. So I looked at that, and I looked into the sjson method, and I thought, okay, this does a few things, like error checking and so on, that are obviously, if you do a library and do it the proper way, you would need to do that. But I could do with a little, with less code than that. So I decided to throw out that dependency so I could update and replace it with this. Do you spot the difference?
You the ZTDP is missing. That was nice. I like that.
Yeah. So it's actually it's one line at the top. New client. Yeah. Okay. So that's.
But if you would use ZTDP, you could have saved that line.
Yeah. And I could
with just one extra dependency.
And it's one array level more. Yeah. You see that JSON thing? It's and also there's no is success on a Guzzle response. Okay. But I mean honestly, pulling in a dependency for this kind of ease of use is, I think, something you should consider carefully, at least. Do you really need that? Or maybe you can use something that's already there.
You have to be technology offen.
Yeah, technology offen. Okay. It's the same technology under the hood, so, okay. Which then, in the end, comes down to, okay, try to remove as much as possible, always. Whenever you touch your code, updating it, cleaning it up, or adding new features, try to remove things along the way, you know. Don't leave commented stuff lying there for ages. Get it back from Git. You can always get it back from Git. You don't need to comment it. If you think, okay, maybe I forget about the fact that I had it once there and just take a note somewhere, you know.
Do you know the Boy Scout rule? Who knows that? Yeah. Oh. It's not making a fire with your code. It's like doing a good what do you
deed.
Call that?
Deed,
a good
deed,
right? So if you have a task and you solve it in your code, and then just a few lines above you see something dirty, then clean it up as well, right? So that's the Boy Scout rule. And it helps a lot because every time you work on your code, it gets a bit cleaner.
Yeah, leave a place cleaner than you find it. And that includes removing settings. I mean, sometimes you just, you know, okay, it's easy to find classes that are no longer used and remove them and remove template files maybe. But even settings, I mean, I found this and I know that I think the usage of magic wand was an experiment at that project, in that project at some point in time. And so it probably never got really used. But I know that the Lilith's capture package was actually used at some point, but that has been dropped quite a while ago. But these settings were still there. And in the end, that always means if you look at the settings file, you cannot be sure if it's still needed. It might be gone already. And there might be, I don't know, credentials in there that are no longer used, but maybe still valid, so you're carrying around those in vulnerable places and stuff like that. So really clean up after your you know, if you remove something, just, you know, get rid of all the remains that you had at some point.
Oh, that's me.
That's you. He's the value object.
I'm the value object.
Goodbye.
So, who's already actively using PHP 8.2 in their project? Wow. Look, Derek as well. For PHP. Yeah. That's nice. Yeah, and as you know, I mean, the plan is that Flow 9 will actually require PHP 8.2, which is nice because then you can rely on being able to use PHP 8.2 features. It's not just being compatible, but actually use it. And I've been going through projects for a while now this year and refactored them from mostly PHP 7.4 to 8.2. And that is a complete, this is a paradigm shift. This completely changed my code style, especially when I was working with something like DTOs, data transfer objects, read models, and the like, and value objects. So what I want to recommend is try to use value objects wherever you can. So do you know what a value object is? Yeah. So let's look at a, I would say, modern value object. Of course, I'm also just sitting in my cave and doing my thing, so I don't know if that is actually state of the art for everyone, but this is just a class. It's a final class. It has a constructor, and if you don't know that yet from PHP 8, these are promoted properties. So that means this constructor will require that you pass it a domain name, organization identifier, and all that, and will automatically set these as public properties of this class, and additionally make that read-only. So that was something you couldn't do with PHP 7, of course. There you would have a constructor and then getter methods to make these properties read-only, right? So this can now neatly be done just with a constructor, and that's the whole class you need. So this is now an immutable value object. So there are a few specialities I want to mention. So first of all, you see that there are three properties which are optional, or actually they are nullable. You still need to pass them. You still need to pass null if you want to skip them. But they can be null. And that is also something I changed over the time. I very seldom use optional arguments in methods. So imagine you have some kind of method, and then you have a flag like retry, and that is true by default or something. So previously I would say I define a good default and make that argument optional, but I don't do that anymore because I think it's better to explicitly have to state what you want. Even if true would be a good default, it might be that you want to add additional arguments over the time, and then what do you do with the optional argument in the middle? You have to put it at the end and so on. So these here are kind of optional, or actually it says they might be there, they might exist or not, but you have to be aware that they can be set. Okay, let's go a bit further. Validation. So the argument for using value objects is that you can be sure that the values are already validated. At least syntactically, they are right. Okay, so if I use this domain value object or model, it's actually a model because it's composed of value objects. Okay, but I can be sure that the domain name, for example, is valid. Or in this case, I can be sure that the passed domain name SHA1 actually matches the given domain name. It doesn't really matter what it's doing here, but just the point, do that in the constructor right away so that you can be sure this whole model here is validated. Now we have a bit of a problem with the space down there, but you see, you can also add additional properties which are read-only, which are not passed, but can be used as a convenience later on. So for example, is this domain in use? That can be automatically determined because either it's assigned or redirected, and if it's either assigned or redirected, it's in use. And now I have a little convenience property I can always use in my code if this domain is in use. And you can set that directly in the constructor as well. Yeah, somehow that got broken again. It's funny. We had a little transfer problem with it looked different on my machine. It's really weird. It doesn't have to do with fonts. Anyway, so...
So if someone knows a good testing tool for keynote presentations...
Yeah, end-to-end testing for keynote. So just one last thing I want to show here. There's this public property domain status. And previously that has been a huge hack. Like at some point when I was preparing a view, I wanted to add some information which is not persisted anywhere or not in a projection, but it's like in this moment I want to add the status of some DNS whatnot. Okay? So previously I might even have used a dynamic property. Just set a new public property because it's used in the view. And this would be the more cleaner version of it. So there's a public property, it's not read-only, it's nullable, but it's a value object or even a model domain status. So either it's null or I can be sure that there is a domain status which is fully validated and I can use that in my view. So this is, I mean, because not everything is always completely clean and so on, but this is a okay way to afterwards add information to that value object model thing. Okay. And now finally, what do you do with this? You actually can use that, of course, in projection, for example, if you're using event sourcing, or use that with DBAL as a read model. And in order to create that, what has changed now? Nothing really. You might add some from array method, which allows you to convert, for example, from a database state to this and instantiate this model here. It depends on what you have there, how that code looks like. And then you also might want to have a toArray and a JSON serialize method. And now you can use this model consisting only of value objects. There's no string, there's no integer and so on. And use that in a range of applications like for GraphQL or for DBAL or for just passing it around or in an action or something like that. But my point is, try to use value objects wherever you can. Don't rely on strings and so on. It also helps you when you are confusing the order of arguments when you call a method. Imagine you have 10 string arguments and then make a mistake and pass the wrong string in the wrong order. That cannot happen with value objects because it must be the correct type.
Also, it makes our life a lot easier because whenever we touch code, we have this urge to, you know, add type declarations. And if they're already there, we don't have anything to do. And if they're not, and there's lots of strings, but at some points it's actually integers being put in, or the other way around, which happens more often than you might think, it's always this, so I added these type declarations, and then at some point the test fails, and you go like, why is it an int? It said it was a string in the doc block. So that's...
Right.
So I guess please do it.
It's my turn, and as you might see, this is turning out into kind of a feedback sandwich, right? So there was Carsten with the crazy stuff in the beginning, and then Robert with the nice value objects in the middle, and now I'm back to the weird stuff.
But isn't the nasty part supposed to be in the middle? We have to... that's a weird sandwich.
Well, it's a...
With a bad aftertaste, maybe.
We are in Berlin. Probably someone does a burger the other way around. Yeah, so whatever.
Nasty burger.
The nasty double. Yeah, well, whatever.
Vegan.
Carsten played into this before, but I saw this a couple of times in multi-site projects where, I mean, you could argue if that was a good idea from the start to make a multi-site project, but then starting to share node types and fusion code in between those sites, like just including fusion from other sites and using node types from other sites, that gets complicated really fast if you want to update, because it is super hard to figure out what is where and how you untangle it at some point. So I would advise you, if you go the multi-site route at all, then really keep it strictly separated. And you can create utility packages that just include node types or just fusion or both that you then depend on for your sites, but that which are not sites themselves. So that's fine. I mean, then you have a shared base. That's okay. But then you also might want to inherit from those node types and create specific ones for the separate sites so you can adjust later on. I have seen the weirdest things where properties were declared and then in another site they were just not used and stuff like that, because it was kind of the same teaser but then not, because it didn't have a slider in it or whatever. So and that is, it's a nightmare to update and to maintain. So keep those things separated. It will help you in the long run.
By the way, also disable the demo site. And don't use the node types. I see two customers in this audience who I know had the demo site running for quite some time. I'm not looking at you.
The demo site, the setup, you can also disable this or remove the setup from your composer JSON if you don't.
Yeah, but that's not as hard to detect.
No,
because the demo site is usually very easy to see, because you're using dimensions. No, we are not. Yeah, but you have them in your settings. Where does this come from? It's the demo site.
Yeah.
So that's the way to find it.
Another thing I have seen in a couple of projects that were a bit older and then they came to us and were like, could you update this, is front-end build pipeline rot. And you get in there and you try to set up the site on your local machine to get an idea of what's going on. And obviously you want to see the front-end, so you want to have the front-end build as well, but it just doesn't work. So you have maybe you have some package JSON in a good case, and in a worst case you have some gulp declaration stuff, but no package JSON even. But either way, you try to install these packages from the package JSON or even the log file, that is almost amazing. And it's just so old that the dependencies are not installable at all. And then you're facing the question, do I start updating the front-end build pipeline, which was not my initial task and will probably take longer than the NEOS update itself? Or do I keep it like that? I mean, what do you do with this? This is really a big problem from my perspective as a NEOS developer, because I don't do so much front-end, so creating a new build pipeline is, from my perspective, not trivial, and probably is not trivial for an old project. That's something to watch for. And then additionally, what I also see quite a lot is huge files, especially in older projects. You have like these 1,000 lines of node types, YAML and settings, everything in one site package, even fusion files with like thousands of lines of fusion, all the prototypes in one. And that, again, is a nightmare to update and to figure out and to make sense of. Ties also into the cleaning up the settings if you remove dependencies. So it helps if you have more packages, because then you can put the stuff where it belongs. So if you have a small package for base node types, you already have the node types in there, maybe a few settings for that, and maybe some fusion for that. So that's one small space, and then you can have a package for your search integration or whatever that has a few configuration parts for that and a bit of fusion for that. And that makes it, to me at least, coming into a project that is sitting around for a while, much easier to understand what's going on, because it's super easy to find stuff, and it's not always the same file you touch, right? So if you start updating, you want to do it incrementally, and if it's always that one fusion file you change, you quickly get lost in that. So having split files is super helpful for later updating and maintaining this stuff.
I have a technical question. We have from our diary, we have 348 slides left.
Yeah,
but I roughly also see that lunch is coming near.
Yeah.
Do you have like two specific things you want to mention, and maybe half a question from the audience after that?
I think the next two we should quickly go
through.
Yeah, right?
I think we should do some. Yeah. Go one further. Document and share, which. If you had this front end build pipeline rot one further, it would have been a nice transition, because what I usually do is, okay, I need to build the front end. How? Oh, there's a README. Oh, it says to be written. Okay.
Exactly. So it usually says getting started with this library.
Even that. Well, this is Neos 3.1. Okay, no, this is not. Okay. Anyway, go one further. So well, I think that is also important. No one, give it to me. Just So documentation is important, and then part of that, if you come into such a project, is finding out why something has been done in a specific way, so you can actually judge if it has been intentional or was just an accident. So write meaningful commit messages. So sometimes we see this, and it's like, okay, fix, okay. Okay, well, I don't know. Let's look at the diff then.
And have commit messages at all? Like have version management, please?
Do incremental small commits, ideally, and use version control as well.
I did download files from servers frequently.
Yeah, okay.
Like there was no version. It was just whatever was on a live server. That was my...
Yeah, that I usually then put that in Git for...
Oh, yeah,
you
of
might,
course.
Actually, you might search for these commit hashes in the internet and see who that was.
No, they don't exist. I changed them manually. So, because, IP and everything. But sometimes you have this, which is a bit better. So it has ticket numbers. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Do I have access to the ticket system? Yeah, we can arrange that. 3 weeks pass. Okay, you have access to the ticket system, and you see this, which makes sense. At the time you write this, it's totally clear what this is about, because this test server is broken right now, and you need to fix it. You need to fix it today. So why should you write anything further? It's totally obvious, except. Starting tomorrow, it's no longer totally obvious.
And the next commit message would be fix it again, or really, or now really.
That's true. So I would recommend to do it rather like this. It's not really important what it's saying there, but even if there is a ticket that says what this was about, also write meaningful commit messages. Really do that, which is part of work on your project documentation. So really do that.
Right. So the documentation, as you mentioned, the README, the empty README is not the worst case, but one of the worser cases you can
it's
have.
It's at least disappointing.
Yeah,
it's time.
Quite disappointing. I mean, if you want to have it perfectly prepared for everyone coming into the project, please have information about the front-end build pipeline that is not rotting, but current, and some idea how to build this stuff and how to install it. Then maybe have some information how you set this up on a dev machine, like do you use DDEV or something else? Do you use LocalBeach, anything? Is there some Docker information? What do I do to create it, to run it? Then also maybe some information about ops dependencies. So, do you need anything outside of PHP and the web server and the database? Is there any special stuff, Elasticsearch or anything else that you need? Then, how do you usually deploy it? Like, is there deployment scripts in that repository, mm-hmm. or is it somewhere else? But at least some information how that is usually deployed. And then finally, some what I call special stuff. Like, do you have special caches that need to be flashed on a deployment, or is there some external APIs that need to be accessible for you to...
Or only deploy at midnight. Or
exactly, yeah.
Never on a Friday.
Yeah, full moon, stuff like that. Always check the full moon website appearance because it looks different and we need to make sure that it works. So that kind of stuff, I would expect that in a README, and it would be super great if you do that.
Yeah. So we'll just do it like this. So you can later on stop the YouTube video and look at the slides that we would have talked about. Still.
And there's some subliminal message included in every slide, so all the explanation is when you play it very slowly, okay?
Yeah, and sometimes even backwards. So that's it from our side. Do you have any questions?
They do.
They
oh,
do.
No.
Oh no!
Oh no!
Maybe, oh, hi. Hi. Mark Henry is concerned about models with two array calls with further two array calls inside the two array calls because he's worried about unexpected or hard to control dependencies and asks, wouldn't it be better to have a separate class to translate the whole model tree to an array instead of letting the responsibility be in the model?
It depends.
I've heard that yesterday from someone else.
Yeah. It really depends. In my case, this was the right solution, but yes, and you can have factories and whatnot. It depends, really. There's no
if you need it, you need it.
Remember the second slide? There's no syllable. That's not the one way to do it most of the time.
And for example, if you use, I use that with GraphQL, and sometimes you need like, you have a customer account, but you also want to have the billing address, but you don't want to put it in there, so you might add a billing address query property, which returns a query which you can use to get the billing address. That's also like a cheat, but it works. Nice. So I do that.
Whatever you do not have a shot every time a speaker answers with, it depends, will hurt you. Okay, another question that just came in is, can you supply a best practice for README files? It's quite hard to evaluate what is the best practice for and MVP for READMEs.
I guess I had a good explanation just now, but I mean, I would be willing to set up...
I don't know. I usually try to remember the last README that I opened where I thought, okay, cool, that's nice, and try to, you know, use that as a mental template. The order usually is, okay, how do I get the code, which at that point most of the time is already, you know, no longer needed because I'm looking at it. But from there on, so how to set it up, how to get it running, and then maybe an overview of what are the important parts, you know, anything that is not obvious, and then try to think not obvious to you. Okay, so not obvious to someone looking at this from a fresh perspective, and try to describe that really. But maybe we should at some point just create the template.
Some companies actually have standards for that, and yeah. I like that. So maybe, I mean, it depends. You have to sit together in your team and come up with a nice template which explains everything to newbies.
But we could make one.
The audience has a suggestion that you're going to really like, I think. Someone in here suggested that they found out that ChatGPT can help a lot in writing a README documentation from your code, which one can then edit and enhance manually, so no excuse for bad READMEs.
And it's usually 80% correct. That helps a lot.
Yeah.
Just make sure you remove the rest of the 20%.
Yeah, you need to check it afterwards. Okay, cool. Need to try that.
Last question. Keep it brief, and I want an answer from each one of you.
Okay.
Because this question came in like right after your talk started, so it has nothing to do with the talk. I think this is an actual question to you. What are the best tips that you can give to someone who just started out using NIOS? Oh, I'm going to step in, join the contribution day. I'm going to take that one for myself.
I guess definitely join all the channels, join Discuss, join Slack. Go ahead and ask questions. No one bites you. No one is expecting everyone to know everything. Even simple questions, it's no problem. People will answer even the simplest question. There's no dumb questions, no wrong questions. Really ask, because we are there and we will help you. Like this is the basic thing. Just go in there. Obviously use the documentation and the examples that are around the web. But if you don't know, just ask. It's perfectly fine.
It boils down to don't be afraid. We don't bite. And then really try to also not be afraid of trying out things. You know, I mean, look at all the stuff that's there. Look at the documentation. Look at the code that is in our public repositories. And then just play around with it. Be curious. And then push out whatever results you have and have it looked at by others to help you improve, which is usually a very good idea.
And don't be afraid to, if you don't find the answer directly, then don't be afraid to look into the code, actually. It's the PHP code is quite understandable for many, and it can give you insights in how things worked. And don't look everywhere, just get a step deeper into the code, and you'll find most answers. And actually, you can also download, for example, docs.neos.io. The whole source code is on GitHub. Maybe that is also good for getting started to see an actual website in action. You can learn from those examples.
Thank you so much. We're practically on time, too.